Try. Yeah, like I said. All right, well, welcome everyone. My name is Ian Scarfe. I'm the director of the Trinity Alps Chamber Music Festival, and welcome to my home studio here in San Francisco. Today we are doing, gosh, I don't even know, it's like our 26th or 28th or 35th digital concert. We started these last year, not long after the pandemic shut down live performances. And it's been a great way to just keep in touch with people and keep our musicians performing music like we all want to be doing. And so we are really grateful for all of you for tuning in today, just to keep, you know, keep your pulse on some of the music and the musicians that we are putting together. Today's program is going to feature two of my wonderful colleagues, and I'll be accompanying them on my little Steinway piano here. Up first is our friend Paula Karolak, who I will introduce to you in just a moment. Paula is a wonderful violist. I met her at the San Francisco Conservatory of Music, and we have collaborated many times through Chamber Music Festival programs and so on. We wanted to start with a meditative piece of music by the Italian composer Ludovico Einaudi. Einaudi is a composer who is still alive today and working hard and writing lots of music. His music is tremendously popular. You know, if you just heard me say this is modern music by a living composer, you might have said, uh-oh, what are we in for here? I only like classical music, you know? Never fear, Ludovico Einaudi's music is so wonderfully listenable. And it is going to wash over you. We kind of treat this as like our little moment of zen to begin the program. So thank you all again for tuning in. I am going to switch to a different camera view and introduce my friend Paula Karolak. We hope you enjoy. This is called Two Sunsets by Ludovico Einaudi.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Again, our friend Paula Karolak. That was music by Ludovico Einaudi. Thank you all so much. That was, if anything, just a little bit of an appetizer. We will hear more from Paula later. But now we'll do a short set change, and I'll introduce you to my friend Jane Spencer Mills. Jane, welcome.
Thank you.
Let's do a little test. Jane, if you use your speaker voice and speak to the camera, will people be able to hear you as well as they hear me? Stephen, would you let us know? Jane, go ahead.
All right. I will use my speaker voice or my teacher voice. Stephen, how does it sound?
You're audible, but not quite as loud as Ian is.
Not quite as loud as Ian.
It's pretty good, though. I think it's pretty good.
Wait till she gets singing, huh? No, in the meanwhile, we can share the microphone.
Okay.
We are friends. We can do that. Jane and I met some years ago, and we've collaborated on so many different song cycle projects, from the classics like Schumann and Schubert to contemporary composers here in San Francisco like Jake Heggie and other friends of ours. And today's program, we are going to be doing songs by the American composer Samuel Barber. Now, Barber is one of my favorite composers. I've been playing a lot of his piano music lately. I think most people who recognize Barber or can think of his music, they probably first think of his incredibly famous work, the Adagio for Strings. The Adagio for Strings is from his string quartet. It's a slow, just gorgeous, emotional, cathartic piece of music. If you know it, you know what I'm talking about. If you don't know it, goodness me, as soon as this concert's over, get on YouTube or whatever and go look that up. But prepare yourself. It's heavy stuff. So Jane and I have prepared a set of 8 songs by Samuel Barber. Actually, 9, I think. But we have them set into little groups. The first one is a grouping of 3 songs that are settings of poems by James Joyce. James Joyce, the Irish poet and writer, who ended up living in Europe for quite a time. These 3, do you want to introduce anything about these 3 poems before we do them?
Here I am. The poems are the very first one is, if you've ever been up in Muir Woods, you'll have a sense of sort of where he's talking about this idea of this, the deep, well, we've got some people from Northern California as well, right? So
right.
You understand when you get into the forest and you breathe that well-oxygenated air, how you really feel kind of rejuvenated. So I think you will get that sense from these poems. One thing I did want to mention, Ian, is that all of these songs that we will sing tonight were published after Barber passed. So his partner, Menotti, allowed these pieces to be published after he died. And so some of them have not been performed as much just because they weren't published within his lifetime. So those of you who know the string quartet and know the hermit cycle and so forth, add this to your repertoire for your ears.
Very good. Thank you, Jane. Okay, so these are the first of our sets. These are 3 songs on poems by James Joyce, by the American composer Samuel Barber.
Soft tumult.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. If I turn away from the camera, it's because I'm looking at the computer where I can see you all applauding. That's great. Thank you. Those were three songs, like I said, set on poems by James Joyce. This next one is by one of the great American poets, Robert Frost. And, you know, similar to what we just heard, especially in that first of the Joyce, this one also is a celebration of nature. And I think this one does a great job of depicting a specific sort of New England scene. The poet describes, going through the woods and then stopping on someone else's land, you know, someone else's farm, someone else's woods. And, you know, this kind of quasi-mystical experience of communing with nature. And this will be paired with another one. I'm cheating a little bit. I'm looking over here. Music When Soft Voices Die, a poem by Percy Bysshe Shelley. I wish Zoom had a subtitles feature so we could put the poems in here as well, because they're wonderful. But
rely on rather accurate diction.
No, I think your diction is great. But they're such wonderful poems that they're worth looking at. So. You can do whatever you like with that. So the first one is called Stopping by Woods on a Snowy Evening, a poem by Robert Frost. The second one is Music When Soft Voices Die by Percy Bysshe Shelley. We hope you enjoy.
Stopping here to watch his war.
his harnessed bells a shake to ask if there is some mistake. The only other sounds the sweep of easy wind and downy flake. The woods are lovely, dark and deep, but I have promises to keep, and miles to go before I sleep, and miles to go before I sleep. Music, when soft voices die, vibrates in
Thank you very much. Sorry, I'm grabbing a microphone. Poof, poof. Next, we're going to do a set of three songs. And these all have connections in the poetry, the theme of love and unrequited love and so on. This first one, as we've talked about, always reminds us of a famous song by Schubert called Gretchen at the Spinning Wheel, where the piano has a sort of a spinning wheel kind of figure that goes up and down and up and down. And the main, you know, the speaker is Gretchen, who is going over her psychological turmoil of being, you know, in love and slighted by her lover. And this is kind of a more modern, you know, take by an American composer, American poet. Do you want to introduce this and the following two little love songs?
Sure. Well, her lover is not as awful as Faust. And she's saying she's distracted. She's talking to her mom, but she does say that there is one good thing about him, and that's sort of the punchline here. But she will not end up dead somewhere in an asylum, so this one will live. The second one is Love at the Door. It is translated from the Greek Meleager. I don't know it, but it is translated, and it's talking about how love can be a place to hide for a little while to find comfort, whether that's hide from a storm.
And the piano
is absolutely storming behind me. You can see the clouds gather. And it is not necessarily a final comforting place, but it is kind of a place where you can hide for a little bit until you can go back out there again. There's a lot of sort of oceany feeling about this one. And then the last one is a setting of Elizabeth Barrett Browning's Thy Love. And it has some connection, I think, with some of the things we've been doing with some Clara Schumann recently, talking about, if you're going to love me because of love, not because of anything I might change to make you love me more. So it's really asking for a genuine connection. So we thought that might be a nice way to leave you with the singing.
Yeah, very nice. I think these three of all the songs we've done, again, this is music still of Samuel Barber, but these three are the ones that remind us the most of the sort of classic romantic songs. You know, we're talking about music of Schubert and Schumann, Robert and Clara Schumann. And all of these have thematically relevant things, both in the text and that sort of romantic style, and musically speaking too. I think you'll hear that. So we hope you enjoy this little set of three. Again, music of Samuel Barber.
See, I'm so distracted by this guy. Anyway.
Mother, I cannot mind my will. My fingers ache. My lips are dry. Oh, if you felt the pain.
Thank you very much. We have one last little song to play, And this one we have made our own little arrangement of. This is going to feature viola and soprano. This is one of Barber's songs called Sure on This Shining Night, a setting of poems by James Agee. James Agee, you know, Barber, this is not the first time that Barber took a gander at Agee's text. His famous symphonic work with a vocalist, Knoxville Summer of 1912, is one of my personal favorites of all of Samuel Barber's music. And that's a setting of kind of a free-form prose-poetry combination text of James Agee. But this Sure on This Shining Night is a wonderful example of Barber's music. We're going to reset ourselves so we can all see some music here. So we hope you enjoy this little impromptu collaboration. This is what chamber music is all about, right?
You get to sit here. that's set.
Would you rather be here? I could move this over?
Could do that, then I block you.
Okay, and then you'll just look
okay.
Over. I mean, is that enough for you to see?
I should be all right.
Sing to the cat.
Excuse me. Sorry, I keep hitting this microphone. I know you probably all hear it. I don't hear anything. Thank you so much, Jane. That was our friend Jane Spencer Mills. And our latest collaboration was on the American composer Samuel Barber. And I really enjoy how some of that sort of called back to these old songs of Schubert and Schumann, because the next part of the program is entirely going to call back to the music of Schubert. In fact, it will be the music of Schubert. Paula and I have been putting together this wonderful sonata by Franz Schubert, this sonata in A minor. This is one of many, many, you know, pieces of chamber music that Schubert wrote. Schubert was one of those composers who just, it's just stunning what he accomplished in his short life. You know, he wrote so much music and so much really great music. And all, you know, he died at the age of 31. And it always just sort of makes me do a double take or think on that, because, you know, 31 is just, you know, 31's pretty young, even for people who die too young. And so poor Schubert, if only he had given us more time, if only he'd had more time. But in his life, he wrote a staggering amount of music. He wrote parts of 10 symphonies. He wrote masses for orchestra and choir. He wrote quartets and quintets and trios and all kinds of chamber music. He wrote piano sonatas and piano marches and piano dances and four-hand piano music and over 600 songs. I mean, the guy was absolutely, he had both quantity and quality, I'll say that. But one of the kind of strangest little pieces that he wrote, I mean, it's not strange music, but it's a strange circumstance, is this sonata. This sonata was not originally written with the viola in mind. It was written for an instrument called the arpeggione. An arpeggione was kind of a new invention in 1815. It was played like a cello between the legs, but it had six strings like a guitar, and it also had frets on the fingerboard, also like a guitar. So it was this weird kind of guitar-cello hybrid instrument. Like I said, it was invented in 1815, and it was all the rage until about 1816, when people realized it wasn't that great of an instrument, or I don't know what happened. But during its very short little heyday, the arpeggione was like quite popular, and none other than Franz Schubert wrote a little piece for it. So the arpeggione has a tremendous range, you know, which is why it's, I think, very well suited to an instrument like the viola. The viola sits in the middle of the string family, you know, between the low cellos and the high violins. And so the viola is kind of able to get around the range in this piece. This sonata, like so many, is in three movements. There are three sort of chapters to this little story. The first one sticks for the most part to this key of A minor. It is melancholy and has this kind of wistful tune that the two instruments pass back and forth. But this being Schubert, he never stays in one mood very long. The music changes so quickly, and it almost like you know, we're moving through a dance scene or something as different themes pop up and he moves to brighter keys and so on. The second movement, the second chapter of this story is very much in Schubert's lieder style, in his style of writing for the human voice. And so you can hear the piano sort of takes a back seat and just lays some harmonies similar to these songs we just heard. And the arpeggione, excuse me, the viola in this case, takes the soloistic singer's role and sings out this beautiful melody. The second movement is wonderful. The way it ends is interesting because it ends with a little cadenza, like a little improvisational moment where the violist is invited to kind of improvise her way into the third movement. So the second movement and the third movement are kind of connected by this little improvisational tissue of music that bridges the gap between them. The third movement again returns to, you know, think of young Schubert going to all these Viennese dance parties, you know, where everyone was dancing and having fun and playing music. It's just like that. It's like one dance after another. It's almost like you hear it come to a conclusion, and then it's almost like Schubert says, no, we're not done yet. Someone else dance with me, and he'll launch into another thing. Altogether, this is about, I think, 20 minutes of music, maybe a little more. Are we taking the repeat? Oh, we're taking the repeat, maybe a little more. So this is just great music by Franz Schubert, some of the most tuneful and great. By the way, even though it starts in this melancholy key of A minor, I should tell you, don't worry, things will brighten up. This is Schubert after all. He will find a resolution. He'll find his way to the joyous major key. So we hope you enjoy this, Schubert's Sonata in A minor for the arpeggione and piano.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Music of Schubert. It's just good for the soul, I think. Thank you. Thank you. As usual, you know, now that we've concluded the musical part of our program, I thought, you know, we always want to take a little bit of time just to, as long as we're in the same Zoom room together, to have a little moment of conversation, of discussion, any questions you might have for me or either of my colleagues. I think if you like, you are welcome to absolutely just put a little question or a comment into the chat here. Otherwise, I think, you know, you could also raise your hand and do so. There are ways of doing that. Before that, though, it's my duty to remind you, as the director of this music festival and responsible for presenting so many of these concerts, you know, this concert is presented as a free event, as a pay-what-you-can event. And so I just ask that each of you consider, you know, what these moments of music are worth to you and, you know, how much you think you can support musicians like these and a music festival that continues doing programs like this. I would love it if you would all take a moment and just go to the Trinity Alps Chamber Music Festival website and make a small contribution, small or large, you know, whatever that may mean to you. I'm going to put it in the chat here. TrinityAlpsCMF.org is the website. Any contribution you make will be so appreciated. You can do so on the website using a credit card. It's very easy. If you'd like to make a charitable contribution through our tax-deductible 501c3, there is a special flag on the website for exactly that. It's the donate button. That'll go through one of our fiscal sponsors. Or, you know, if you're old-fashioned, you can send a check in the mail. You know what? I love getting mail. So anything that shows up in the mailbox, you know, it's a little bit quaint these days, opening some mail, right? So anyway, that is my pitch. Thank you for attending this event, and hopefully you will contribute a little bit to support these kind of festivals and these kind of musicians. I'm looking at the chat, and I see some comments coming in. Our friend Margaret Augustine, one of these days, how about the Trout Quintet? Of course, she's talking not about something composed by Mr. Trout, but something composed by Franz Schubert. Schubert's wonderful quintet for violin, viola, cello, and double bass and piano, so-called Trout Quintet, because he wrote a little set of variations on his own song called the Trout. That is a good little suggestion, a good request, Miss Maggie Augustine. Hopefully sometime soon. We need to get one of our double bass players in there, you know. A double bass takes up a big part of the living room, so we need to maybe rearrange some furniture. I see our friend Prima Swearegen. Thank you so much. Thank you, Prima, for being here. My friend Catherine Lucchese, thank you for being here. Catherine says, what a lovely evening. Would anyone else like to chime in? You're welcome to simply unmute yourself. You can raise your hand and chime right in if you like.
Hi, when are you coming to Eureka?
Christine Stenland, nice to hear your voice. When we will come back to Eureka, I know that we have plans for our annual winter series to happen in January. The exact date is not yet certain. We were hoping earlier this fall or late in the summer months to do a program at the Morris Graves Museum, but, you know, the surging cases in Humboldt County made the museum postpone all of their events. So we were unfortunately one of those. So yes, hopefully soon, not just in Eureka, but in the whole area in Weaverville and Redding and North State, California as well. What are your concert plans for the rest of the year? I'll turn that to my companions, to the ladies. Do either of you have concert plans for the rest of the year that you want to share?
Most Paula? Immediately, Symphony Parnassus.
Oh, right. Tell us about Symphony Parnassus. What is that?
Symphony Parnassus is a ensemble in San Francisco where professionals and non-professional musicians meet and rehearse under the tutelage of Stephen Paulson. And we have our concert in early November, and I would check the website.
Right, and that's here in San Francisco, right?
And Herbst.
In Herbst Theater, all right, downtown San Francisco. Great. That Symphony Parnassus, that's a great group, and Stephen Paulson, the conductor. I played with them once years ago. It was one of the best experiences of my college days. Jane, do you have any musical plans?
I do.
Tell us about them.
Things that are solid. I'm one of the sopranos in International Orange Chorale, San Francisco,
and we are back in rehearsal. We look great in our singerly masks. We're rehearsing and we are preparing some amazing brand new music premieres that will be performed in December, early December. And I think also check the website for the location and the time, because I don't want to tell you something it's not. Please join us. It's an a cappella group, and we the mission is to provide free concerts of current musicians, living musicians, although sometimes we have people who have passed. It's fabulous music, so come here.
Yeah, excellent. Okay, I just put those in the chat if anyone wants to make a little look, take a little look. International Orange Chorale is what Jane's speaking about. A chorus that does contemporary works and all kinds of wonderful music. And then Paula referred us to Symphony Parnassus. So anyone in the Bay Area, those are great things to check out. As for my plans, I don't know. You know, life is so chaotic. It's so hard to plan ahead these days. But we're trying, so stay tuned. If nothing else, we will see people again here on Zoom. There are lots of things that we're trying to cook up. We'll see how many of those actually come to fruition this winter. Well, thank you all again for being here and for your support. I see Brad and Elaine, the Thompsons, put in the correct link, trinityalpscmf.org. Thank you for that. The Thompsons and their little son Ryland, who I gave a piano lesson to the other day. How's Ryland doing?
Is he practicing? Are you going to ask that?
No, he's not practicing. I don't care if he's practicing. You know, he's a little kid. He should just have fun, right? That's what music is for. Music is for having fun. I see our friend Lori Gallagher is here. Hi, Lori. Nice to see you.
That's a clear, beautiful air up in the Trinity Alps.
Yes, that is great. It's been such a rough summer with all the smoke and wildfires, so yeah. We're glad to hear that. Hopefully, we'll be up there visiting soon.
I check the maps pretty regularly.
Yeah.
For Trinity.
Yeah, those of us in the city who are close to the area, we keep a close eye on those fire maps, the CAL FIRE updates. So that's great to hear. All right. Well, thank you, everyone. I think this brings our evening to a close. If you don't mind, what I would like you all to do is please help me thank our special guests today, Paula and Jane, by unmuting yourself and applauding like crazy so that we have something to go off on. That is wonderful. Thank you all so much. Until next time. Bye-bye.